Listening Library presents She Persisted, Coretta Scott King by Kelly Starling Lyons and Chelsea Clinton. Inspired by She Persisted by Chelsea Clinton and Alexandra Boiger. Read for you by Karen Murray, with a letter written and read by Chelsea Clinton. For my mom, grandmothers, aunts, and all of the sheroes whose shoulders I stand on. Thank you for your commitment, brilliance, and love.
Dear reader, as Sally Ride and Marion Wright Edelman both powerfully said, you can't be what you can't see. When Sally Ride said that, she meant that it was hard to dream of being an astronaut like she was, or a doctor, or an athlete, or anything at all, if you didn't see someone like you who had already lived that dream. She especially was talking about seeing women in jobs that historically were held by men. I wrote the first She Persisted and the books that came after it because I wanted young girls and children of all genders to see women who worked hard to live their dreams. And I wanted all of us to see examples of persistence in the face of different challenges to help inspire us in our own lives. I'm so thrilled now to partner with the Sisterhood of Writers to bring longer, more in-depth versions of these stories of women's persistence and achievement to readers. I hope you enjoy these chapter books as much as I do and find them inspiring and empowering. And remember, if anyone ever tells you no, if anyone ever says your voice isn't important or your dreams are too big, remember these women. They persisted and so should you. Warmly, Chelsea Clinton.
Chapter 1, Strong Roots. Named after her grandma Cora, Coretta Scott came into the world connected to a deep legacy of faith, bravery, and belief in the importance of education. Everyone knew she was destined for something special, but no one, not even her parents or Coretta herself, could imagine that one day her voice and strength would inspire people around the world. Born on April 27, 1927, at home in Perry County, Alabama, Coretta was the child of Obadiah Obie Scott and Bernice McMurray Scott. They lived on family land in a house her father had built. Surrounded by the power of people who loved her, Coretta felt safe and protected. But outside the safety of their home, there were dangers everywhere. In Alabama and throughout the South, segregation, racist laws that separated black and white people, was the rule. Being black meant you had to drink from colored water fountains, go through back doors of businesses and restaurants, and only be served after whites were. You were called hateful names and faced the danger of being hurt or killed because of the color of your skin. The weight of oppression was as thick as summer Alabama air. But the Scots surrounded their kids with the winds of possibility. In their proud black community with family all around, there was a history of land ownership, hard won and passed on. The Scots knew land was a complicated issue full of injustice. The forced removal of the Muscogee people from their homelands and the terrible institution of slavery built wealth for some people while keeping others down. Decades later, many families who lived near Coretta's didn't own land and had little money. The unfairness broke Coretta's heart. But being with her family brought her joy. She dreamed and explored as she played with her big sister Edith, little brother Obie Leonard, and cousins. She climbed trees, swung on tire swings, and wrestled boys. She was imaginative and strong, and proud of it. We were much better off when we created our own games rather than things you buy from the store, she said. Sometimes Coretta would gaze in the mirror and wonder what she would be one day. She believed that God put everyone on earth for a reason. What was her purpose? Coretta found direction and inspiration in her heroes, her parents. Her mom had only finished fourth grade, and her dad, 1 year of high school, but they were the smartest and most honorable people she knew. Her father owned his own truck and hauled lumber for a local sawmill company, and by making his own way in the world, he showed her what it meant to be independent and creative. Her mom, a seamstress and homemaker, instilled in Coretta and her siblings the value of faith, education, artistry, and hard work. Little Coretta helped her sister take care of the vegetables and feed the cows, chickens, and hogs on their family farm. When she got older, Coretta and Edith worked for a white farmer to help pay for their schooling. Unlike white students in their area, black families had to pay for books. When the sun woke up, the Scott sisters started picking cotton with the heat beating on their backs. The days were long, tough, and tiring. The sisters didn't finish until the sun went to bed. But Coretta put her all into it. She knew this work was a path to something more. "You are just as good as anyone else," her mother would tell her. "You get an education and try to be somebody. Then you won't have to be kicked around by anybody, and you won't have to depend on anyone for your livelihood, not even on a man." Sunshine or shower, Coretta walked with her siblings 3 miles to Crossroads, their crowded one-room school, where more than 100 kids of different grades learned side by side. On the way, a bus filled with white students would pass them. Some days, the driver would splash mud or make clouds of dust fly into their eyes. Coretta knew the school the white students were going to had a library, unlike her school, which didn't have as many books. White students got to attend school for 9 months instead of 7 like she and her friends did. Why did society treat her people that way? Living in segregation brought daily pain and heartbreak. Coretta couldn't stand having to crowd into the jam-packed balcony at the movie theater while white folks got to be comfortable on the main floor. She hated going to buy ice cream and only getting what flavors were left after the white customers chose. Racism hurt, but Coretta didn't let it shrink her spirit. Her parents taught her that. Jealous of her dad's success, white men would stop him late at night to try to scare him. They would curse, pull out their guns. No matter what he faced, Obi Scott looked them in the eye. When things like this happened, Coretta's mom's words rang in her ears. "You are just as good as anyone else." Coretta remembered that and walked with her head held high. Chapter 2, Gifted Voice. Freedom for Coretta came from her family, schooling, and her special gift, singing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.